again. Now, I've represented some typical state from the Bloch sphere. But there's nothing preventing this vector to lie not on the north pole or the south pole only or the equatorial plane. It can lie at any point on the sphere. So, yes. So the gentleman is asking what are the axes for these, for the sphere. So what should be the answer to this? Is this the x-axis, which means one of the cardinal axes? Is this the y-axis? No. It's a representation of a qubit, which is a two-level quantum system. The axes or the directions of this sphere represent the states. A state pointing, one state points in another direction, another state points in another direction. So the axes are merely representing the state. It does not correspond to any axis which we conventionally think of as an axis, right? Now, the point is that quantum mechanics has the uncanny ability to surprise you, because not only alpha and beta, 0 and 1 are two discrete states, but these coefficients could take up any possible value, provided this constraint is met. So alpha and beta can take up an infinite number of values. The sheep are okay? Rukia. Now, if I draw the Bloch sphere, this vector, which is a quantum state, living in a quantum space, can point its arrow, its tip can point at any point on the surface of the sphere, anywhere on the surface. So let me draw a general quantum state. This general quantum state is again represented by this mathematical form. It's a superposition of alpha and beta, and the values of alpha and beta will determine where this vector lies on the surface of the Bloch sphere. If alpha is 1, beta is 0, then the state lies on the north pole. If alpha is 0, beta is 1, the state lies on the south pole. If this is 1 over under root 2, 1 over under root 2, then the state lies on the equatorial plane, and so on. Alpha and beta can be quite simple values. देखते हैं ना ये तुम्हें बताने जा रहा हूँ ठीक है. Now what we would like to do is the following. Now if I look at this vector here, which is pointing in an arbitrary direction, what parameters are required to describe the orientation of this state? How many parameters do I require? Three. What are those parameters? X, Y, Z. If the radius of this sphere is 1, always 1, how many parameters do I need? 2. Just 2. What are two convenient parameters that would specify the orientation of this state? Angles. I heard the word angles. Which angles? Right, so I need angles. One convenient angle is this angle, right? The angle from the z-axis. Okay? Let me call this angle theta. Okay? Generally, this angle is called a polar angle or an angle of co-latitude. So if my state points on the north pole, my angle theta is 0. If it's on the south pole, angle theta is 180 degrees. If it's on the equatorial plane, somewhere on the equatorial plane, it's 90 degrees. What other angle would I need? I would need this angle as well. Let's call this angle phi. So if I specify theta and I specify phi, phi is called the azimuthal angle. And theta is for the polar angle. If I specify these angles, I can specify the position of the quantum state or the position of this vector on the surface of the Bloch space. I only need these two angles, right? That's it. Alright. Now, the question that I would like to pose to you as a challenge or as a puzzle is that if my quantum state is psi, it has a probability amplitude with ket 0. Some coefficient, could be a complex number, goes here. And some coefficient goes here, could be a complex number. And I would like to have this number and this number a function of theta and phi. What should I put here and what should I put here? I give you 2 or 3 minutes to think about this. I would like to have some function of theta and phi that I insert in here for the probability amplitudes that recovers this Bloch picture, that recovers the picture that I've drawn over there. Just I give you 2 or 3 minutes and then I'll seek your responses. Couple of minutes of silence to think for the slow or for the deep thinkers. Sochen. Alright, first of all, just to keep your life simple, you can see how can I describe this state? What should be the coefficients over there in terms of theta and phi in order to describe this state? I'm going to make life simpler, slightly simpler. In terms of theta and phi. Anyone? Please speak up. Cos phi. Anyone? तो क्या डालूँ वहाँ पे? अगर जीरो के साथ क्या डालूँ? cos theta cos phi theta 90 degrees कर दे तो वो तो जीरो हो जाएगा. cos phi डाल दे. cos phi डाल दें जी, cos phi डाल दें, phi क्या zero, तो उसके साथ क्या डालेंगे मान के साथ? Sin theta. All right, so this is a proposal. The proposal that we've been presented with is, let's put cosine theta here and sine phi here. Now, if theta is 90 degrees, you want to put cosine theta here? Or cosine phi? Cosine phi. Okay, let's put cosine phi here. And what do you want to put here? Sine theta. Okay. Now, when phi is 0, I'm here, I'm talking about this state. If phi is 0, cosine phi is 1, but you need a 1 over under root 2. You don't need 1, you need 1 over under root 2 with this. So this is immediately incorrect. Right? And so this actually doesn't make sense. So this is incorrect. Yes?
What if it's pi by 2?
Pi by 2. Phi or theta? Phi. Here? Like this? Here theta by 2. Let's try this out. Phi is 0. So this turns out to be cosine of 0, which is 1. But you need a 1 over under root 2. You don't need 1 here. So this is incorrect as well. So this is incorrect. I would like to write something here as a function of theta and phi, and something here as a function of theta and phi that has the ability to describe all of those diagrams. Right? I want to describe all of those diagrams, not just one of them. Yes? Kya karte? Psi kya hota hai? Phi. Phi, cosine ya sine? Cosine of phi plus 45, right? Aur yahan pe? Sine? Alright, if I put phi equals 0, this gives me cosine of pi by 4, 1 over under root 2, fine. If I put theta equals 90, this gives me 1. Alright, so this is theta by 2. Theta is 90, so this is 1 over under root 2. This is 5 plus pi by 4, so phi is 0, cosine pi by 4 is 1 over under root 2. So I have, very good, I have actually described this state over here. Really good. But the problem is that can that prescription describe this state? Can it describe this state? Can it describe this state? No. So I need a universal description that has the ability to describe all points on the sphere. Can anyone think of such a universal description? Yes. Shabash, good. Cosine, just hold on. Cosine theta over 2 gets 0 plus
sine theta over 2 tan e to the power I phi.
Excellent. Now this is actually a universal description of an arbitrary point on the Bloch sphere. Now if I insert different values of theta and phi, it all turns out perfectly alright. Theta is, if I'm on the equatorial plane, theta is 90 degrees. So on the equatorial plane, this is 1 over root 2, this is 1 over root 2. And this factor corresponds to how much my azimuthal angle is. How much do I move on the equatorial plane? So if my phi, let me draw a diagram that expresses all of this. Drawing a Bloch sphere, so let me first look at this case. I call this ket 1. Okay? This straight. Now theta here is 90 degrees. So I take the cosine of 45, which is 1 over root 2, ket 0 plus theta is 90, theta over 2 is 45, sine of 45 is 1 over root 2. At this point, phi is 0. E raised to power iota 0 is 1. So, that formula works. If I look at this state, cosine theta over 2 is again 1 over root 2 because theta is on the equatorial plane everywhere. The angle of co-latitude is 90 degrees. So theta over 2 is 45 degrees. 1 over under 2 ket 0. Sine theta over 2 is again 1 over under 2. Now what is my phi here? What is my phi on position 2? 90 degrees. So E raised for iota pi over 2. But this is simply equal to iota. So my state is 1 over root 2 ket 0 plus iota 1.
Likewise,
I can have other states. I can have this state. I can have this state. So it all works out. I can have an arbitrary state here. An arbitrary state, the state need not lie on the equatorial plane. It could be anywhere in the upper hemisphere or the southern hemisphere. It could be anywhere. There's no requirement that the state must lie on the equatorial plane. So the general form is what I've written over there. That is a qubit. And this is the representation of a qubit on a Bloch sphere. Now when you do quantum computing, you generate superpositions. For example, I have, now I'm going to draw a quantum circuit. I draw a wire. I'm drawing a model of a quantum computer. I draw a wire, could be a photon, could be an electron, whatever you do in quantum computing with. Some physical implementation, we're not concerned about the physical implementation at the moment. We're drawing a language. We're picking up a language that describes generically a quantum computer. Alright? So this is like speaking Esperanto language. Esperanto language is a universal language that everyone is supposed to speak according to United Nations Charter. It's a universal language. It's not English, French, German, Urdu. It's a universal language. So I'm talking about a generic language here that describes quantum computers. So this is a wire that carries a qubit. The qubit could be ket 0 or ket 1 or something, and you have a device that creates a superposition. Now this is something which is totally missing from a classical computer. You cannot create a superposition. This is where the power of quantum computing creeps in. It puts its foot into the door and just tries to unravel its power by the ability to create superpositions, which has no classical counterpart. So you have some logic gate, some device that creates a superposition. Let me represent this logic gate by the symbol H. Okay? What this does is that it has the ability to create a superposition. Alright? Some device, like a beam splitter, creates a superposition of two parts. Something that creates a superposition. Okay, I'm not talking about the physical picture of it. So this creates a superposition, I get F0, say, plus 1 over under root 2. So this is the superposition that this device creates, which I've labeled as H. Why have I labeled it as H? Because it is in honor of a mathematician with the name Hadamard in the 19th century. Anyway, I have some logic gate that creates a superposition. Then I would like to have certain transformations on the qubit. Remember, I used the word transformation somewhere when I'm discussing logic gates. I would like to transform my qubit. I would like to transform quantum information. So I would need to build special gates that have the ability to do that. Okay? So let me give you an example of a quantum NOT gate. Okay? We've talked about qubits, we've talked about superposition. Now we would like to do something useful with it. So we've created a superposition, now we would like to build gates. So that we can do quantum computing. We could process information in a quantum mechanical fashion. Okay, and Bloch sphere again gives us an idea of how we are able to do that. So what I would like to do is, I would now like to build a quantum NOT gate. And I would like to represent this physically on a Bloch sphere. What should such a gate do to a state on a Bloch sphere? How should the state change on the Bloch sphere? Any single qubit operation can be described by transformations on the Bloch sphere. The qubit is described by, it lives on the Bloch sphere. The qubit lives on the Bloch sphere, so if I want to change my qubit state, I would have to manipulate the state so that it can move on the Bloch sphere somehow. So let me give you an example of a quantum NOT gate to begin with. And then we're going to talk about entanglement and quantum teleportation, etc. If I were to draw the truth table, if I were to draw the truth table of a quantum NOT gate, I would like to represent qubits as my input. Okay? So one state is F0. Remember, my qubit lives in a space which is two-dimensional. Which means that in order to describe the qubit, I only need these two states. and some coefficients with these two states. Okay? So it's a two-dimensional system. These are my basis states. A vector that lives in two dimensions requires an I component and a J component. It's a two-dimensional vector. A vector that lives in three dimensions requires three basis or unit vectors, I, J, K. A qubit lives in two-dimensional space because the basis states are two in number, H0 and H1. I can create an arbitrary qubit by superposition out of these basis states. So now if I would like to write down the truth table, it will just have two entries. I will see how the quantum NOT gate acts on either of the basis states. So if the input is ket 0, what's the output? Ket 1. I would like the output to be ket 1. If my input is ket 0, I would like my output to be ket 0. So this defines the operation or the transformation that a quantum NOT gate would do. Everything is a corollary of this. Everything comes out of this. For example, if my input state for ket 0 minus ket 1 or plus ket 1 over under root 2, what's my output state? What's my output state? What happens? Now quantum mechanics, remember, is linear. So when a quantum knot acts on this state, what's the output? Ket 1. And when it acts on this state, what's the output? 0. So I get the same output. Doesn't change. Alright? So if I had a superposition and a quantum NOT gate acting on the superposition, the state will pass unscathed, unchanged, undeterred. Alright? But everything stems from this truth table. Everything comes out from this truth table. Now if I were to draw the Bloch sphere, which I would always draw in yellow, if this is my input state, ket 0, and I would like to transform it to ket 1, that's what the quantum NOT gate is required to do. So I would need to have some operation, some transformation that takes this state at the North Pole and brings it to the South Pole in order to achieve a NOT gate. Now transformations on a qubit, I need to do some logic gate, some quantum operation that performs this rotation. I need to rotate the state. Right? It's a rotation. A logic gate in a quantum computer is a rotation on the Bloch sphere. Agree? I need to rotate the state. Now, if you would like to rotate the state, if you want to rotate, do a rotation, what would you need to specify? How much do I need to rotate? How much do I need to rotate? How much do I need to rotate for the NOT gate? 180 degrees. Is that all you need? The amount of rotation? The axis of rotation. You need an axis of rotation as well. So, if this is my axis of rotation, then I can rotate about this axis. The axis remains fixed and the state goes like this. Okay. If this is my axis of rotation, and this is my state, my right hand is my state, with this axis of rotation, my state goes like this. So the axis of rotation is also important, as well as the amount of rotation. Alright? Now in order to achieve a NOT gate, I would like to give you 2 or 3 minutes to think. What should be the proper axis of rotation and what should be the amount of rotation? You already told me the amount of rotation is going to be 180 degrees. could you now think about the axis of rotation that is required to achieve this NOT gate? What should be my axis of rotation? And it should not change. For one state, you fix the axis of rotation, it should be the same for all other states. What is a universal description of a NOT gate? I would like to find out the axis of rotation, the amount of rotation you've already told me, 180 degrees. I give you 3 or 4 minutes to think about it. Implementing the NOT gate. What do you mean by imaginary? X or Y? Or which one? If I were, which axis? This axis, some other axis? This axis? Okay, so the proposal that's come forward is let's choose this axis. Now this is not a quantum state. This pink vector represents an axis of rotation. Let's look at this idea. If this is my axis of rotation, so this is my axis of rotation, that's what you said. Okay? This is the axis of rotation parallel to this. Let's call it the y-axis. Don't take the y to be too literal. But this is my axis of rotation. This is my initial state. And I rotate about this axis by 180 degrees. I start from the North Pole. The amount of rotation is 180 degrees. I cross the equatorial plane and come down onto the South Pole. I land in ket 1. Indeed, 0 has gone into 1. So this row of the truth table is satisfied. Now let's look whether the same axis of rotation would satisfy the second row of the truth table. My starting state is ket 1, which is down on the South Pole. And now I would like to rotate by 180 degrees by the same axis. So I will go down, move on the southern hemisphere, go up the equatorial plane, and now I go back onto the North Pole. Correct. Okay. So this also appears to be correct. But is that the complete story? No. That's not the complete story because suppose I started off with this state. I started off with this state over here. And my axis of rotation remains the y-axis. Now this is my axis of rotation, this is my starting state. The NOT gate should do nothing to this state. Right? However, it does rotate this state as well, so it goes like this. South Pole and back onto the minus x-axis. So this 0 plus 1 under this rotation goes to 0 minus 1, which is not what we desire. So at the outset, this looks like a good axis of rotation for a NOT gate, but actually it isn't. So if I have this axis and this state, is something going to happen to this state? It's going to rotate. It's going to go down south pole and then back up, and it will end up here at pointing in the minus x axis. So this state is 0, minus 1. So, but you require 0 plus 1 to remain unchanged, invariant. It should not be changed under the action of a NOT gate. So this is not a proper axis of rotation that defines a NOT gate. Okay? Can you come up with another axis? X-axis. An axis of rotation that is parallel to the x-axis is a proper implementation of a quantum NOT gate. Alright? So I would like to stop here, but I would like to talk, give you an idea about entanglement. Entanglement is one of the strangest features of quantum mechanics. And in the next lecture, we'll look at this resource and see how it can help us in quantum communication. Thank you very much.